Start service now. Happy Resurrection Sunday. If everyone will please stand, we're going to play The Father's House. That's where you're at. 1, 2, 3, 4. Teachers, some of our faithful teachers
that have gone to different things. So we need more people to step up and to take your place. We have a couple. Ashley is now teaching, so thank you, Ashley. And Kevin here has been with us for quite a while. He's back teaching again one Sunday a month as well, along with Jackie and along with
Kate.
Thank you, Kate. So that's four, but more than merrier. So please, you don't need any experience. All you need is a love for children and a willing heart, and we'll show you what to do from there. National Day of Prayer is coming up in 2 weeks from this Thursday, I believe. It's Thursday, May the 5th, and we'll meet at the flagpole, which is right over here, in front of the Sheriff's Office to pray for our country. And boy, we need prayer right now.
Amen.
So, if you can't be over there, you can pray wherever you are on that day at noon. Just stop and pray with us, and we know you're there in spirit. So it'd be a great thing. The more people we have praying, the more powerful it will be. So let's continue with our worship service. Traditional greeting is, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
A traditional Easter greeting in the Western Church is exclamation, He is risen. And traditional response is, He is risen indeed. Most of you do that. The words are sometimes accompanied by an exchange of three kisses on alternate cheeks. In the Orthodox and Catholic churches, the greeting is called the Paschal greeting. It's a very old custom. The greeting is ultimately based on Luke 24:34. The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. Exactly how the saying became a standard greeting in the church is not known. We do know that at first the greeting was more common in Eastern and Byzantine literatures than in the Western church. There's a tradition in Eastern Orthodox Church, the saying was made popular by Mary Magdalene, which supposedly addressed Emperor Tiberius in Rome with the words, Christ is risen. Using this address should be more than an empty tradition. The words, He is risen, remind us of the joyous union we celebrate at Easter, that Jesus' death was not in vain, and that He has the power to overcome death. Saying, He is risen, allows us to share this incredible truth with each other. The resurrection of Christ gives us hope of salvation and for our own resurrection and eternal life. So one more time, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us pray. Father God, we ask you to be with us as we gather here on the day we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Christ has conquered the grave and has taken his place by your side in heaven. We serve a risen Savior, and by his death and resurrection, we have forgiveness of sins and reconciliation with the Father. We ask you, Father God, to bless each person who comes here today to worship you with us. Today is indeed a happy day, for he has risen. He has risen indeed. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're very lucky to have, every once in a while, we have people come from different churches, and Tori sings at Sierra a lot, and she's singing with us today. And today she's going to sing for us all, Habib the Father's song.
Make a rich his treasure.
His wounds have paid my ransom.
So, we stand for the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
is the day when we know that his amazing grace was here. He rose from the dead, and the proof to everyone was there that Jesus could beat death. This is amazing grace. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Offering time to him. I thought Kai did a really great job today of selecting the songs, especially for Easter. If you notice, almost every one of those songs contains the gospel message. And the last one, I think, summed it all up, Amazing Grace. The whole thing is just God's wonderful grace for us. He knew we were separated from Him. He had to find a way for us to get back right with Him. So it was through His grace that we did that. First of all, we learn through the songs and through the gospel, through the Bible, we are all dead in our sins and fall short of the glory of God. The book of Romans, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. God sent His Son to die on the cross, to pay for our sins, and reconcile Himself to us. On the third day, Christ was raised from the dead, and those of us who believe will be saved. Romans 10:9. That if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. And 1 Corinthians 15:20-22. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all be made alive. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for Your sovereign plan of reconciliation and salvation. We thank You for Your gift, the greatest gift You could have given, Your Son, Jesus Christ. Because of Your gift and His death, the death of Your Son, Jesus, on the cross, we have salvation. We shall one day reign on high with Him. Oh, how we look forward to that day, O Lord. But until that day comes, we will serve You here where You have planted us. We desire to serve You with all of our hearts, all of our minds, and with our tithes and our offerings. We thank You, Lord God, for watching over this church and providing for all that we need. We ask that You bless all who have come here today to worship in Your name. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Children, now we have a couple. We have children's church. We got Alec. We got Theo. And we have Chloe. And our older ones. So I like to pray for them and pray for their teachers as they leave. Father God, we thank You for bringing children to us. We pray, Lord, that they are blessed with this time of their own worship service. Thank You for those who volunteer to be teachers. Be with them, Lord, and allow them to teach children the gospel as is written in Your holy word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Brother Jeff.
Thank you, Ted. Take this thing, because you know this will be the first thing I drop. I'll pick a lot more. You see, I drop my nose. Better.
Yeah.
Hey, what a beautiful day in Lake Tahoe, huh? Pretty awesome, isn't it? And you know what's unique? I know a lot of you were here for Good Friday, but didn't it fall just right into the scene, the 3 hours of darkness? You know how it just fell? Gloomy, we had the rain and everything. And then here we are on the resurrection. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Think about it. I mean, it's a beautiful day out there now, isn't it? Pretty awesome. Comes up with the sun and how glorious it's going to be. And I know a lot of you are going to get out of here and walk down towards the beach. It should be a beautiful day. You know, I worked hard on this as putting a sermon together, putting a message together. I take it very serious to handle the Word of God. And, you know, I'll make mistakes. I guarantee you that. But from His Word, You give the glory. I once said to somebody, I said, you know, plagiarism. Now, if you're in school, you hear plagiarism. That's not good, man. You get an F. But if you plagiarize Jesus Christ, you're doing okay, because it should stay the same for the last 2,000 years. There shouldn't be any change in it. I want to thank all of you. There's members in here that I love, that just came and helped me with putting the message together. And I know a lot of you may not know, Wanda Gonzalez was our previous pastor. Well, just to give you an idea how in touch he still is with this church, I had a question on the message. I texted him at 2:30 this morning. At 2:35, he got back to me. So, he's an Oklahoma. So, pretty crazy, man. Well, before we plant, I call this the ultimate vacation. this message I'm giving you, an ultimate vacation. So I hope, pray that everybody gets something out of it. The word is from the Bible. You know, I always say, this is one of my cues, if, you know, when you work to get an appliance in the house or your car, you get an owner's manual. Well, if the world started giving us owner's manual, I think we'd be in a lot better shape. That's it. Anyway, join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for those that are here. I thank you that have the ears to hear, Lord God. And as I stated, give all the glory to you as we digest the message, take it to heart, and we use it throughout the week, throughout the rest of our lives, Lord God. So, life-changing if we let it be. Lord, I know I'll make mistakes. I take those humbly. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to be before you. I ask for repentance for all the sins of my life, Lord, and just be forgiven. These things we ask in your name, amen. Okay, now all of us have a favorite vacation spot we go to. Jerry's been traveling around every place. I don't know what's your favorite. You've been all over the place. And a lot of you, you don't have to raise your hands, but a lot of you are vacation here, I'm sure. And so, on vacation, I know all of you have these great memories and just the past memories of the vacations you've taken. Annually, a lot of planning goes into it. You got to have reservations. You got to have the funds together, right? You got to have the dinero to do it. It's part of the whole thing. Now, let's say a lot of you are probably vacationing in Tahoe.
Amen.
Amen. Right? That's it. Amen. Amen. Yeah. That's good for all of us, right? Those that live here. And a lot of planning and preparation in advance should go into that head down. I can unequivocally say that without a plan, coming to Tahoe can be a disaster. It could be a disaster. Now, usually, you know, leaving some of you come out of the Bay Area, you just don't jump in the car and say, hey, we're going somewhere, you know? Or you don't go to Houston, you don't get on a plane in Houston or LA and say, hey, we're going to Tahoe, or coming up here, without any plans. That can be unequivocally one of the most disastrous vacations you have. First and foremost, you can't, if you think about it, just last week, to get over the mountain, you need a chain, it's over 50 and 80. You know, and you want to have blankets in the car because you don't know how long you're going to be there, a flashlight, and hopefully some water and maybe some food. And carrying chains, that's just automatic. Blankets. And if you get here and you don't have reservations for a place to stay, I got to tell you, you're out of luck. And you got to have reservations now, not only for that, for lodging, for your meals, even if you're skiing now, for lift tickets. I know up here, we got to have reservations for our rental equipment. Think about that. You bought a lift ticket, and you go to get your rental skis, you pay $200 for a lift ticket, and they say, well, you don't have reservations. Believe me, there was some heat on that one at Hope Valley. Okay, unprepared is the worst way we can be. Now, what I'm going to do is take us on the ultimate vacation. We're going to plan for it. My hope and prayer is everyone in this building will join us, and everyone will meet on the ultimate vacation. That's eternity. That's eternity. What happened?
Lost you.
See, Sue, you're not the only one. Good to see my neighbors back. That's She told me not to put a tie on this morning. My wife did. Kaylina organizes everything I say or do. Believe me, I'm old school, so that's hard. No, I do everything with stick persons.
Older.
What's that?
Older. Older.
Okay. Oh, man. My hope and prayer is everyone in this building would join us and meet for this ultimate vacation. A trip of a lifetime, the lifetime, eternity. What always befuddles me is we talked about preparing for your vacation to Tahoe and getting up here. You know, we spend so much time. I mean, Sue and I, if we go on vacation and we're planning, we're loading things up, we got the finances, we got everything in order, we got Jungle Jim coming by the house to check on, make sure everything's still there. Everything is in order. But I got to tell you, we do things out of order. We've done this where we've gone down to Nevada Beach and expect to get a campsite, which is right down here at the beach. And bingo, there's no sites left. In fact, they open up for reservations on February 1, and by noon February 1, you're not going to get a site. It's just the way it is. So, with that in mind, how many of us really plan for an eternity? The vacation we all want to be on. That's our hope. The vacation we all want to be on, how do we plan for that? You know, it's stated in the song, in Amazing Grace, the original version, 10,000 years. I mean, this is it, man. This is going to be awesome. And everything we desire will be met. Pretty amazing when you think about it. Now, in that statement, your desires are going to change. Trust me. Everything will be a little different. Whoa, what happened? Is this the day? Do anybody hear trumpets? Okay, just some statistics on how little time we spend on preparing for eternity. Recent survey was conducted by LifeWay. 75% of us believe in heaven. 58% believe in hell. I can't figure that out. Where's the rest? 99% believe in Jesus in some format. They believe in Jesus in some way. Jesus was real to them. They believe that. If we're among those,
let's get this man a mic.
Yeah, I can handle it.
Yeah,
this thing's going all over the place.
Going all over the place.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can put him on one mark. Turn up his
center. Him in one spot.
Turn down the monitors. All the way on one, and then turn up the sensitivity. We'll just leave this here, and it'll pick you up, sir.
It will?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
All right. Thank you for your patience, everyone.
You know, Mike reminded me, I worked at the Sahara when Elvis Presley came in and did his show. That's putting back a little bit. I remember him walking downstairs, but he sang Amazing Grace. But he was doing things with the mic that I couldn't do here legally. We should spend time preparing for the journey. And that's what we're going to do today. Again, as I told you, this is the manual. This will take us from A to B, where we need to go. And when I started, I actually started with the children's Bible. And I tell you, I still use it today. One of the sermons I did, I put it together through a children's Bible. Those are the tools. Anybody need one? God, what is the plan? What's it all about? God promised salvation, and the only way is Jesus Christ. I'll spend most of the time in Corinthians chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It's Paul's third journey. He provided instructions for the Corinthians 2,000 years ago, and those instructions haven't changed. They're still the same for us. We live in a world that desperately needs hope. Please don't tell me. We need hope. And you wouldn't believe this, but I'm going to tell you something. Sidebar. I was here, I don't know, maybe my wife can attest to this, before 6 o'clock this morning. And I come in here and I practice. Jim can attest to it. And I was here at 8 o'clock. I must have did something wrong. Okay. So, this the hope that he was taking to Corinth, that Paul was taking, was the same hope we need today. It's 2,000 years ago. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Paul is writing to some folks to give them hope about the resurrection, eternity. These are the Corinthians, his third trip, and still many things they didn't understand, they didn't get. And just like us, if we're not in this, you know, a lot of times we want to take it my way, I can do it, I don't need the church, I don't need the fellowship. I don't need it. And that's sort of going my way. In order to grow, we got to know. And we got to continually fellowship with one another. That doesn't mean we don't get off track, but we're accountable. We're accountable to each other, and most of all, to the Word of God. Now, brothers and sisters, this is his message. I want to clarify for you the gospel proclaimed to you. You received it and have taken your stand on it. You stand firm on it as you receive it. He wants to make it clear it's for us, just as he did for the Corinthians 2,000 years ago. Paul makes it crystal clear then and now, the gospel is the good news. And that's what we refer to, the good news. For what I received, Paul states in verse 3, is of the utmost importance in what I want to share with you. That Christ died for our sins according to Scripture. And you know what's amazing? This is a fact that the death, the birth, the burial, and raised on the third day according to Scripture, there's 24,436, I believe, and it's changed. There was one picked up. That's how much evidence there is archaeologically for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's a fact. That's what's found. I used the word on Good Friday, if you're at the Good Friday service, contestalessia. Did I get that right, Sid? That's good. That's a good word. And I put it in my phone, and Sue put it there. Contestalessia. Okay. What that means is your debt's paid in full. And I really like that. And that's used in the Greek version. That's what the Greeks use to translate the whole, what Jesus went through, and our debt was paid in full. That's pretty cool when you think about it. Okay. What's unique? Isaiah 53:5. That's the Old Testament. 750 years prior to this event had prophesied it. But he will be pierced for our transgressions, which he was. He will be crushed for our iniquities. The punishments brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. By everything that took place is our healing, is our healing. Hope is alive because the gospel, the good news, is received by us. Step out on it. Don't be afraid of it. Step out on it. Don't be ashamed of it. Be bold. I've been there. I've been ashamed. There's times I didn't speak up when I wished I would have speaked up and should have speaked up, and it came back to haunt me. Step out. Stand on it, and you're saved by it. Paul is making it very clear. Christ died for our sins. But he didn't just die. He didn't just die. He died for our sins. You know, some people say mistakes. I have a hard time with that because, you know, I make mistakes all the time. The police officer behind me told me, hey, you just made a mistake. So you make mistakes. So he's making it clear that that's what it's about. He paid the debt for our sins. I often hear, I just want what I deserve. Trust me, you don't want what you deserve. You don't want what you deserve. Because when we get what we deserve, we're not going on any vacation. You know, I bring this up, I brought it up Good Friday about sins, and we're all there. And if you've been in one of my messages before, I used my daughter Sammy at 8 years old, coming to me one day. I wasn't here, I was at the house. She was 8, she's 29 now, Sue? 29. She said, Dad, have you ever had a day without sin? And I said, yes. Then I woke up. You know, it's what it is. It's what it is. You're going to have to stand before him each and every day. That's part of this thing, the walk we have with Christ. He paid the debt for our sins. And it's so critical. If we get what we deserve, we're in real trouble. This is the very, very good news I'm giving you. This is the foundation stone for us to build upon, to change the course of the direction in our lives, the purpose. It's a short journey on earth. You know, and it's a one-to-one ratio. You're born and you die. It's the only one-to-one I know about. And the only one ever to overcome that was Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Paul put it this way in chapter 5. And I previously stated this. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 5. God made Jesus sin who had never known sin. Why? So that we could become the righteousness of God in him. That's where we get our righteousness from. And that's a lifetime process. It doesn't we turn over and we're righteous. As long as we're vertical, we continue on learning and learning. And when it's time to go home, we'll be delivered and we'll have the full righteousness of God. Do you see the transaction that's taking place? Do you see what happens? He's on the cross bearing our sins. And we, in turn, are getting his righteousness. It's filling up. And it's continued. You know, you learn something every time you're involved in this. That's why you don't want to set the word aside the Bible. You want to get into it every day. A good friend of mine, I give him the daily bread and go through it. It gives situations that are real, and you relate them to God's word and follow what he has for you. It requires obedience. We get the love. It requires obedience. Jesus takes on the guiltiness of our sins. And we get to take on his righteousness. Each and every one of us. And we build upon it. Again, what does it mean when we receive it? Stand on it. And what does it mean when we're saved by it? Okay. I got to tell you something. My wife told me the last time in Good Friday service, I should have had some water. I just needed some water. Do you see any water anywhere? Where? Right there? Well, I believe you, but I can't see it. How do I get to it?
Walk up the stairs.
And then I get the water?
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. That sounds cool. I get it. I believe what you're saying, but I don't quite see it yet. I was going to do this blindfold. Could you imagine what it is? So, what he's saying, can you hear me?
Yes.
I got the word. What basically Matt's given me and his sister is a testimony. Given me the word, I got to stand on it, step up, and drink the water. Man, that's good.
It's going to be a little thirsty, doesn't it?
What does the water represent? It's the living water. The living water. Do you understand that? Do you see where I'm at with that? You basically gave a testimony right there. That's what it's about. Okay, Jeff, he told me. Matt told me where the water was, and I took the water. That's what Paul's trying to tell us. The steps to stand on it, to receive the water. Are you heavy on this? Are you getting this? It's pretty simplified, isn't it? And that's what it is. Can you hear me?
Just fine.
I like it. You know, that's what happens when we've been in Tahoe as long as we have. It just kind of gets on you. We think it's heaven. But let me tell you something. You don't have a clue. Okay, the water. In John 4:10, he talks about it with the lady from Samaria. If you knew the gift of God, who it is that asked you, you'd drink. You would have asked him. He would have given you living water. And Jesus Christ is the living water. The step that I take, that Matt guided me on, that's the faith, taking that step of faith, and reach out to him and receive it. And that's what we have to do. There's going to be a lot of us, you know, we think it's mythology, we think whatever it is. I'm going to tell you something, my journey in life where I stand now, I know it's real. I can tell you the times where I did my will, wasn't pretty. And when I did his will, things changed. So, as we go, and you step out on the Lord, forgives you for your sins, and I believe it with all my heart. I know it, and I've given that message to quite a few of you. And you know what? It's what you need. We can talk about Paul. We can talk about the transitions that took place with people, but I can turn them on to people, to many of you in here, and you would give them the story of how you came to know Christ and what he's done in your life. Main thing, he really is the Son of God, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, according to the scriptures, and he received. That's the truth. And we must receive him into our hearts and into our lives. Every part of it. John 1:12 states, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. That's the path of righteousness. Lean on him. Like I'm leaning on this. It would fall. But lean on him for your forgiveness of the sins. As I do daily, it's a must. You know, you talk about murder and different things, you're thinking, oh man, that dude's out there. We're going to talk about somebody that did that. The reality of it is, when you hate somebody, you're disdain or mad at somebody, that's just like murder, man. You know, one of the things I always caution in elders' meetings and when I'm with people, you know, in the church, brothers and sisters, this is what gets me. Love a brother, love a sister. I love that brother, but, you know, I love that sister, but, you know, who's but? I mean, come on. What's that? Take that all away. It requires believing on him. However, you must take a stand on it and be firm on it. And there's times I've failed at that. And it's okay. You know, listen, we can go back. We can go back to each and every time. This is the day that he rose. This is the moment. and you get to say, forgive me for my sins, Lord. I'm receiving you into my life. He's going to take every turn for you. May not always see it, but it's real. When you get to be where I am on the journey, some say 3 days older than dirt, you can look back and see what he's done in your life. I'm telling you. I'm punching my ticket because the options aren't good. They're going to save you from the depths of hell. You are my Lord. You're going to take me to heaven, and we're going to take the step of faith. Stand on it and receive it. That is precisely what Paul's talking about in 1 Corinthians 15. It's hope. Hope is alive. And this is the evidence of that. I get asked that a lot in the witnessing process. The evidence of that. Well, think about it. The first he appeared to, 1 Corinthians verse 5, 15, 5, he appeared to Peter. This is the man who denied Christ 3 days before that. 3 days. I mean, he was telling, you know, he was getting challenged. He was, I don't know if he was ashamed or what, but he was denied. He was cursing and cussing and said, no, I don't know who that is. Get away from me. So that was 3 days. Isn't it interesting that that's the first person he appeared to is Peter? Wow. And Peter was pretty much a rebel. I mean, he did some crazy stuff in the walk with Christ. So that's an eyewitness. If you think you failed as a believer, just reflect on this dude, because you won't. You can always come back. This is the evidence that of hope that we have that took place. These men hung around because now the other 11, Matthias took Judas and Iscariot's place. But these are the men that first had this encounter with Christ. And that carried on. They didn't run away from it. They carried on. The hope, eternity, for all the days on earth they had. They were planning for the ultimate vacation. Probably didn't know it at the time. Remember, they were persecuted. They were burned, murdered, crucified. Crucifixions took place every Friday. You realize that in Rome, and under the Roman rule, they have crucifixions every Friday. So it could be anybody. They wouldn't give up. Does this exist today? What these 12 men did? Yeah, it exists today. Nigeria is going through it now. Burma. Christians are persecuted in many countries. And it's, you know, we realize how little we have it here when we look out and see what others are going through. Paul goes on to say, after Jesus was resurrected, after that he appeared to more than 500 of his brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. But this time, where we are, almost 2,000 years later, they're all gone. They're in eternity. But as I stated earlier, I can point to many of you, and you can tell those around you and people you encounter through work, through family, your friends, what he's done in your life. It's pretty amazing. For I am the least. And then Paul, in 15, 9, and 10, the apostle Paul, for I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. And he did. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees, well-educated in Jewish customs, traditions, and law. And man, he was tough on them. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. I am what I am. You know, that's in my yearbook. My name, I am what I am. That's pretty cool. Anyway, it is his grace to me was not without effect. In other words, the grace that's given to him, there's a price for it. It's free to us. But there was a price that was paid to steal it. It's not cheap. And that's something you got to keep in your mind at all time. You know, it's not grace after all you can do. It's grace that was given to you. You accept it. Now, they have all died. However, look around the room and you can see the evidence. You know, people are going to come and go, but you're going to leave your mark. And you know how you leave your mark? You leave your mark by sharing what you have with others. Many will tell you the change that Jesus has made in their lives. Then in 15:7, this is cool. Then he appeared to James. James was his half-brother. James was actually a child of Mary and Joseph. And James had no... You can imagine in the family, James didn't believe anything. Not even at the crucifixion did James believe that Jesus Christ was the Messiah. Yet, when he appeared, That's when James believed. I went, wow, there he is. And that was his, the appearance he made to James. Again, James, not the James in the book of the Bible. James is his brother. And he didn't do it until seeing him. He didn't believe. Then he became the pastor and the preacher at the first church in Jerusalem. Receiving it and believing it, accepting it, is the key of eternity. John puts it this way. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right for us to become children of God. I'm asking you to come into my life, Lord. Be the plumb line. Be the straight line on the journey. Be the guidepost. The guidepost. Make sure I don't miss going on the ultimate vacation. I don't want anyone to miss it. Anyway. And you know where it comes from? You hear the term love thrown around, but honestly, the love we show is the initial encounter we have with others. I told the ladies, Kayleen, man, you know, when she sees me coming, she says she knows confusion's on the way. She won't say that to me. And she'll give me a big smile and I'll give her some paper. Hey, how do you straighten this out and do this to get it on the screen? Whatever it is. And that's the way a lot of you are. We support one another. We support one another. We're there for each other. You know, the next one that I like, I have two for you. And some of you may have heard this in the past, Jeremiah. But I was a student at UNR, a geological student, in pure geology. And anyway, too bad Bill Colstead's not here. He's our resident geologist. But it was my second year. I accepted Christ. I didn't know much. I didn't know anything. I had a children's Bible that somebody gave me. And I wasn't a child. Child of God. But we went on a bus trip to a little town called Washington, down there in Nevada City, on Highway 20. And I remember the trip so well. We're in a bus, and we're talking, and of course, this is about 8 o'clock in the morning, a flask of whiskey comes out, you know. Not that I have anything against whiskey, but not at 8 o'clock in the morning. But these guys were saying, teasing me, and I was trying to tell them about Jesus. You know, I said, let me tell you about this Jesus Christ in my life. And I remember Matt Tabor and Francis LePay were two of the people who were sitting with me in the bus. And they just, oh man, they didn't harass me, but they teased me. You know, you're a Jesus freak, man. Well, you gotta get real, man. We're geologists. You know, we know the real deal, science. And I said, come on, man, you gotta at least hear me out. And I was pretty excited. So they stopped the conversation. And I remember Matt, I don't know, it was Francis LePay. He graduated and became a geoengineer. I didn't graduate, but he made it through. And it was about a year and a half after that. We kept some contact, but I knew where he went to work. He went to work for Newmont Mines in Elko, Nevada. And so I didn't think any more of it. This is back in the day. You know, we didn't have the cell phones like you pull out right now. Right? We were on landline. And I get a call, and it's about 2:30 in the morning. And this guy's crying. I can hardly understand him. And he said, Jeff. I says, who is it? And he says, it's Francis. I said, wow, where are you? Elko. I said, is everything okay? I thought something happened. He says, I'm on my knees, and I want you to know I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And you got to realize, Jeff didn't do that. I don't know who I talked to him afterwards. It doesn't really matter. That was God's plan. That's his plan for all of us. It's just we got to be there. I have one more that I like that I can give you a dozen as old as I have. But there's a local legend here in Tahoe. You know, so many times we say, not now. You got to get right before you go to Jesus. I got to get my life right, man. I can't go like this. Let me tell you something. You look at the war that's going on now. There's people that don't have time to do anything. He takes you as you are, just as you are. But this, a lot of you know the name, and I'm not going to say it, but he's a local legend around the mountain and stuff here. But actually, he was born and raised here. And anyway, he does a lot of work for KNS, the radio station. He puts up the on their cell towers. He did back in the day, not that long ago. But anyway, I said, why don't you accept Christ as your Lord and Savior? He says, dude, I'm not ready yet.
I'm not ready. I said, what do you mean you're not ready? He said, I'm still doing reefer. And I said, listen, man, it doesn't matter what you're doing. Now's the time. It'll change. Things will change. God's got a plan in your life. But anyway, he's turned his life. It took some time. And it doesn't matter. It's in God's time, not our time. Another one that we talked about, Amazing Grace. And, you know, it's not limited to the Christian media. Many mainstream entertainers have sung it various ways, 10,000 times, like I mentioned Elvis Presley. It was published by John Newton in 1779. It was actually used as a poem written by Newton. And the song was conviction from his horrific days. You talk about sin. His was horrific. He ran three slave ships. And when I say slave, I know a lot of times we'll think African, you know, Africa. But these were Portuguese, Spanish, Estonia, I mean, people from all Greece, a lot of Greeks. And so he'd run these trains, these ships. And all the time he'd be at sea and he'd go back to port in the UK and in England, his mother would always have a word for him about Jesus Christ. He didn't want to hear it. But now he's on one of these ships and it wrecks. He's in a shipwreck. And it's just him and his slaves. And God had mercy. God had mercy. He was saved. From that point on, he turned his life over to Christ. Gave his life to Christ. And he became one of the strongest advocates for freeing the slaves. In fact, he lived long enough to see it happen again, where the slaves were freed. You know, as I think about that song, A Wretch Like Me Was Once Lost, But I Was Found, that song speaks volumes to us. I pray that as our worship team sang and brought words to us, that everything that takes place is thought for you to give your life to Christ. And you know, I remember hesitating, and then I remember the day I made the decision. And I got to tell you, I'll tell you something personal. I gave my life to Christ on a Sunday in Reno at Calvary Chapel. And the next day, the things that happened in my life, you know what I said? Christianity must suck. I says, this is bad, man. I says, because everything that happened was the next day was bad. To me, in my. But you know what it was doing? It was cleaning my luggage. It was cleaning my bags out. And I got to tell you, from that day forth, and I look back now, I look at my wife, I look at my kids, I look at how life has gone, and the privilege of sharing the word with you and being up here is amazing, the changes that take place. It's like anything else, you gotta be obedient to it. I thank you all for being here, and I pray that this is on your heart, your minds for thought, and get into his word. Get into his word. Now what I'm gonna do is when I'm finished here, close in prayer. I'll be in the back, and anybody feel free to talk to me. I have cards back there with my cell number. It's the only number that we have. Feel free to call at any time, even 2 in the morning. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for the opportunity that we've had to share the gospel with you, God. I thank you for what it means for us, the price that was paid, and this being Resurrection Sunday, Lord, just to feel your presence and know, as I mentioned, among the believers and the people here, you live, Lord. You live. We get to see your activity and what you do in our lives and the changes that we've made every day. Thank you for the blessing for all of us. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
You all stand, please. If any of you think that not any of you are unsaved and you think that you're not good enough to come to God. And you don't know me. You don't know a lot of us and where we've been and who we are. It's not about holiness, but it's about Jesus giving us holiness. You're welcome to that.
I am hurting, broken within.
Who's here, and we were so glad to see. Have a wonderful Sunday.
Amen. Amen.